I am Kolana, the Raven, and this is my story. I knew a woman once that lived in the meadows of North Carolina. We became very close. I was her spirit helper, her guide, in times of need. Many different nations and tribes had come to seek refuge in these very woods. And even though her husband was away, she felt safe. Teaching her children how to live, how to give thanks. Her walks through the woods, gathering herbs. It was a good time. She was at peace. And she was living native. One day, after gathering firewood, she returned back to her village to find it in shambles, destroyed. They didn't know all the details of what had happened, but they had to leave without taking anything with them. What would they do? Where would they go? One of her boys tried to go back in, but they had to leave with nothing. And only the light by Grandmother Moon guided them. She called upon me early that next morning to safely take her back to her village. She just wanted to see. To her dismay, there was nothing. When she returned back to the camp, the children had let the fire go out. She stoked the fire back up, but was angry as she cooked the meal. Later that morning, they went to Fishing Creek to wash up. She spoke with her boys about being angry and how you should never cook with an angry heart, because everything you do is connected to everything around you. Food is for nourishment and should not have those types of feelings over it. She told her boys, I should have taught you this long ago. I've been teaching my daughters, but now the roles have changed. Now we must rely on ourselves. There are no women's roles and men's roles when it's just us. We have to work together. Everything we do, everything we say, is a part of each other. We are one with the universe. Look deep into your heart and mind. Take yourself to a different place. Allow yourself to learn. You can soar over mountains, past seasons, over trees, when there's bad times, always remember, you're in control of your destiny. Be open to change. See, look, son. Change is coming. And I think I hear your father returning.
To be a woman's job?
Yeah. We should hurry up.
Yeah, so, Dad's probably back at the camp.
Now their father had returned home. They were safe. He shared many stories of his travels, showed weapons and different belongings that he had obtained on his journey. The boys were so excited. They wanted to hear every detail. His father taught them that it's important to maintain balance in your life and to protect your family at all cost. He said, I know I've been gone, but from now on, I'm going to teach you the things that you need to know in order to become the man you're supposed to be. The next day, he showed the boys how to make diddy poles, which are bank poles made out of willows. They went to the river and stuck them in the side of the bank to catch fish. He also heard of their disobedience, and he punished them by making them pick up more firewood. He knew he might take a little convincing, but a new home he had learned about on his travels, called the teepee, was going to be their new way of life. Now they could leave, go where they wanted, and take their home with them. A teepee consists of a tripod that is hoisted together and balanced as the base of the home. Poles are made of cedar, pine, and the tallest and straightest poles are the best. It's a group effort, but a teepee can be put up with as little as 2 to 3 people, or in this case, children. Thank you. style varies by tribe. However, the idea is still the same. Building a home takes compatibility between a lot of different parts coming together as one. Each pole has a different role, a different purpose, a different gift. But when they all come together, harmony, balance, and beauty are just a few words that come to mind. A teepee was durable, and it was quick to set up and dismantle. It withheld against weather, wind, and even tornadoes in the plains of the United States. Although originating a certain lifestyle and residents of tribe, teepees have been shared with all natives across North America. Used for ceremony, living, treasure that was holds the stand of time. Thank you. Now, where had that girl gone? I couldn't keep track of these kids. At least one of them had been missing during each of the events in the past couple of days. Although it takes a joint effort to construct such a house, the home was run by the woman. She made the teepee cover. She picked the poles. She picked the site for the camp. And even though most men would say the teepee was theirs, they knew who the boss was. However, the home of the teepee and the way that it was built, coming together, each person having their own job, but unifying as one force, with just one other way, their way of life tied into how they live. Soon these boys would have to learn how to make their own lives and take off and have their own family. And it was the parents' jobs to get them ready. While they worked, they played, and they talked, and they just had a good time. They told their father of how their village looked when they walked upon it, how scared they were, and how happy they were that he was home. He told them that change is something we should never be afraid of. Embrace it. Make the best out of it, and move on. Now, convincing your mother that was a different story. Boys knew that their mom worried a lot for them, but if they only knew what they had been up their sleeve, the surprise was going to be so worth it. As this new home started forming in front of her eyes, she realized how much she had to be grateful for. Even though they didn't have the things that would fill the teepee, We had what was most important in a home. Each other. As long as they were together, they could get through anything. Now, if we could just find a door. The next morning, the boys were sent to find sweat rocks for the upcoming sweat. They needed to make sure that they were purified and in the right state of mind for the seeds to be planted. Everyone's energy works off of each other. So we all had to go into the sweat, and they were excited. They talked about how cool it was to stay in the teepee and how their mom was worried what people would think because they had no possessions to go inside of it. The boys couldn't wait to reveal their surprise, how they had snuck back to the camp and retrieved some of their family's belongings. While their dad was checking the bank poles that he had set, they gathered the items and snuck them closer to their camp so that they could bring their surprise into a reality. And boy, those fish are going to taste so good. Finally, planting day is here. I'm so excited. And by the way, do you know what those boys have been up to?
I don't know. Do you like the new tools that Dad brought?
They're very nice, but the tools of our ancestors are very important, and it's always good to use them too. The sweat lodge is a very important part of Native American culture. Sweat lodges and sweat bathhouses were used tribes ranging from the east all the way to the west. Some used as religious and some used as a purification for the physical body. However, regardless of its purpose, it cleansed the soul inside and out. The Abber Sweat Lodge is made of willow shoots. It can accommodate anywhere from 4 to 15 people, depending on its size. Dirt is dug from the middle to make a fire pit. That dirt is removed on a hide and carried out to the east of the doorway. It is made into a mound, which represents Mother Earth. Painted buffalo skulls used had a very specific purpose. It symbolized the great herds in which the people were dependent and the belief that all things come from and return again to the great mystery. The floor of the sweat lodge is covered in sage. Blankets and tarps made where no light can enter the sweat lodge once you entered. Stones gathered from a hillside and not a riverbed are used, heated, and water added to produce steam. There are very specific ways of running a sweat lodge according to tribe and according to its conductor. It should be held in the most sacred of light. Even when cleansing the sweat lodge, had a great deal of religious importance. The star formation on the top of the Sweat Lodge represents the Milky Way. Many nations believe that we are from the stars, and to which we will return upon our death. According to the legends of the Sioux, the small dark lodge represents the womb of Mother Earth. The darkness of the ignorance of men's mind. The hot stones represent the coming of life, the hissing steam in the creative force of the universe coming into action. The cover is raised to the east, and the source of life and power, the dawning of wisdom upon the minds of men. The elements of earth, air, water, and fire are all represented in the Sweat Lodge. The fire which heated the stones is the fire that never dies, the light of the world, eternity. We still use these lodges today, and we will continue to use them forever. Thank you to the Creator for giving us these ways and a way to connect with Him. In times of sadness, happiness, struggle, and triumph, we look to these ways to continue to celebrate life. The Sweat Lodge ceremony consists of 4 rounds. Every part of our ceremonies, dances, and ways means something, represents a specific element, or pays homage or honor to the Creator, the spirits, or to the ones who are important in our lives. The first stone out of the 7 that are in the first round represents Wangkun Tongka, the great mystery, who is at the center of everything. 4 stones are added in the same way, and the second one being placed in the pit to the west of center, the next one to the north, then east and south. And each time a stone is placed, the man in the rear of the sweat touches it with the stone bowl of the pipe. The pipe is filled with tobacco, and the smoke that rises sends our prayers to the Creator. After each round, 7 more rocks are added, for totaling a number of 28. Water and sacred herbs are splashed upon the rocks that produce a heat that will make the body sweat. The darkness that surrounds you has the appearance of being in the womb of Mother Earth. A rebirth is taking place, a connection like no other. Bad feelings, sickness, can all be alleviated in the Sweat Lodge. The first round is in honor of the ancestors, grandfathers and grandmothers. Second round is for our brothers and sisters, the 4-legged, the 2-legged, the birds, and the creatures of the water. The third round is for those that are still and their addiction. The 4th round is for the specific participants of the Sweat Lodge and their prayer request. I Aho, Matakuyasin, all my relations. The boys could not believe that here it was. They made it through a sweat, and they thought they had passed a test, which they had. However, punishment is punishment, and it was still sticks for them to pick up today. Corn, beans, and squash are considered by the Haudenosaunee people to be special gifts from the daughter of original woman, Sky Woman. As the story goes, when the daughter was dying in childbirth, she said that from her body would come the foods that would sustain the people. From her hands came the beans. From her breast grew the corn. From her belly button grew the squash vines. From her legs grew the sunflowers. And from her head grew the sacred tobacco. From her heart sprouted the strawberry. And from her feet, the original potato. This is the cosmological story that comes to life every time Haudenosaunee people plant a Three Sisters garden. The green corn ceremony was practiced by the southeastern tribes as well. It is a harvest ceremony where they gave thanks for the bountiful harvest that was provided from the Creator. Many of our sacred items and bundles were put on display. Our lodges were cleaned, old pottery was broken, and a new year began. These practices are still done today, giving thanks to the Creator for our ways of life, protection, and provision is something that will never change in Native American cultures abroad. It had been a long but a beautiful day. When I returned back to my camp, our teepee had a door. Our oldest twin was standing guard. What were they up to? Beautiful items that my husband had gotten on the trail were on display. They invited me inside. I was a little nervous of what I would find. My son looked like a man standing there. And as they entered our lodge, much to my surprise, our teepee was full of the most important things in my life. My children, not the hives, not the baskets. But filled with love. All of the elements combining into a space of harmony, of peace, of change. What? The fire is out again?
Wait, I have one more surprise.
We were so proud of our sons, our entire family. For the rest of the day, we enjoyed each other, played games, shot bows and arrows, sharpened our skills, laughed, ate, and just enjoyed each other. Her father was an excellent hunter and craftsman, and he enjoyed showing his skills to them. Storytelling, sharing, games are all a part of passing on our history and our life skills to our children. One day, the twins vowed to be as good as him. Their dad says, until then, they could keep trying. Thank you.
Thank you.